Welcome back, everybody, here to ESL 1 Frankfurt 2016, the European qualifiers. We're pushing our way through the lower bracket right now in this best of three between Na'Vi and No Diggity, as we are one game up for Na'Vi coming off the back of their second place at Star Ladder. They're still over in Kiev, boot camping up for all their upcoming LAN events. And, yeah, this is, obviously, they're going to be there for WePlay, actually, in a week and a half, I believe that is. So, yeah, I'll be there for that one. Yay, go to Ukraine again for the first time in a very long time. Speaking of a man, they'll be attending a whole bunch of LAN events as well, including ESL 1 Manila and ESL 1 Frankfurt. It's only appropriate that we have the captain of Complexity coming on to now cast with me, Schwindels. Welcome to the game.
Hey, glad to be here. Sorry I missed the first one. Blame the organizers for moving the schedule up.
Yeah.
And pack and stuff.
You can also blame me a little bit for not fully realizing the time.
And I should have been more diligent. I was just distracted. I got a bunch of shit to do. My flight leaves in like 3-4 hours, or I got to get to the airport in like 3 hours. So, just quick comment before we talk about this draft. That last game, I think, all came down to just Diggity's draft and last picking Darkseer. I think it left a big hole. You really want to have two things with Darkseer, either a combo off the, you want a combo off the VAC and Ion Shell partners, and you had neither in Diggity's draft. And if you look at it, like Witch Doctor, Enchantress, OD, like none of their heroes really output much damage until later stages of the game, and they just got run over. I mean, it's vintage Na'Vi too, like Dendi's Quap, you got Art Style on Shen, Alone Druid, Beastmaster, Dual Core, like that's, it's so scary strong. So I think Na'Vi like hard won the draft, and that's why they won the game.
Well, let's see how this draft goes, man, because already Na'Vi had themselves the Nature's Prophet. And No Diggity will block up that pick of Art Style's Chen by picking it themselves, and they pick up the Quoit for Puck. Even though we've been seeing Puck, thanks to Starladder, moving a little bit further towards the offlane, I'll be surprised if KZ was the Puck player in this game.
I still don't think Puck offlane is a thing. It's so funny, though, because that was so big in Han, and there's all these Han strategies and ideas just, like, coming into the game now. And I think a lot of it's just because there's all these damn Han players, but Puck offlane was such a huge thing back in the day. I think the main issue we found with it, and what will eventually be figured out, is, like, you can actually just keep Puck level 1. Like, pretty much any two heroes can do it, and he just can't buy an Iron Talon, so... Why pick Puck and put him offlane, right?
Mm-hmm.
Iron Talon, the Edge-Chen interaction.
Iron Talon Puck would be a, like a next thing. I would be...
Yeah, don't tell Z-Freak, he'll try it.
Experiment with it, see it's absolutely shite, and then just stop it completely.
Mm-hmm. Right. Trust me. It took like 3 weeks to get off the Legion Commander jungle thing, because it was like... all he wanted to do.
Well, hey, the original Legion Commander jungle was amazing back when she was doing twice the amount of attacks. That's when she worked really well. But that was a bug.
Yeah. It's interesting that they banned Mirana on Na'Vi. And I'm not quite sure why. Maybe they just don't want to play against, like, OD Mirana or something.
It's a Diggity thing. Both Era... as well as Yapzor actually plays some pretty damn good Muranas. Right. And they run it all the time up against jungle style heroes like Enchantress and Chen. Even though I know they're both running it at the same time, maybe it's just more of that cautious band to start with.
I gotcha. Yeah, I think I like this draft a lot more from Diggity. It seems way more open. They have two cores saved for last, and they can be pretty much anything, because as we like, the Puck can pretty much go to any lane, although it's most likely mid. I think that an Ursa looks really good for them right now. If it were my team, we'd probably take a Tiny, but I like the CM pick. I think it's the go-to counter to Enchantress. I actually don't like Witch Doctor that much against it. I think CM is much better, and it's pretty good against Furion too, so good synergy with their units. Bounty Hunter. It's interesting, because I actually think CM beats Bounty. Like, it's actually a good matchup for CM, even though he kind of typically preys on these squishy support heroes. You can dust and Q and pretty much render him incapable of escaping and then put a W on him. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, I just really like the CM against the Bounty. You're way stronger than he is in the early game if you keep up in levels. And obviously you provide the aura for your team.
Would you also be concerned here with the Na'Vi draft? Because when you run a Bounty Hunter and an Enchantress, obviously you're not running someone with like these core stuns, like a Crystal Maiden does awful. Like, she gives you a huge amount of AoE. She gives you like that straight lockdown with Frostbite, even an AoE slow and damage from Nova. where Bounty Hunter is kind of like, well, I stalk you and I sort of attack you, try and find some kills, but a bounty can't really kill off a Puck in mid because he doesn't really have that kind of stun. Like, he works really great Night up against stalker. Like, well, say here is like Night Stalker because they're just merely here as if they're running a mid, but that'd be a Keizu Night Stalker. Does Na'Vi kind of make themselves a little bit too weak with their support combo when you get a bounty and an Enchantress together?
Yeah, it's an interesting point you make, because I actually agree, especially when you have a hero like Furion, which I think excels in a game where you can continue to increase tempo, get lots of kills, take lots of towers. I actually am not a huge fan of the Night Stalker. I'd much rather that be a more, just a higher damage hero. I think if they just picked something like a PL core with like a Darkseer, honestly, or just any hero that buys a mech so that the Chen can rush Ags and they just get to a team fight. Like, they just win, just because, as you say, like Ench Bounty, there's no, like, they have three heroes with no stuns, rather limited damage output, so I think Diggity would just kind of run away with it. Mm-hmm. The Night Stalker is one of those heroes I don't understand that well, in truth. I think it's really powerful, but it's hard to value the vision control that he gives you. That's like the main benefit of a late game Night Stalker, and that the usefulness of that is kind of dependent on how good the team is running it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah, I know what you mean. Just as well, man, just to let you know, I think you're still on your webcam mic.
No, it's not possible. I can switch headsets real quick. It might just, is it like,
it just sounds like you're talking from inside the room.
Interesting. That's all. Okay, here, give me like 2 seconds.
You're all good, man. You're all good. Take your time. And we're in no rush. We're still here in the drafting phase, so you got time. But Na'Vi now needs, so we need a Dendi hero right now. Unless Didi Ra's can be playing this Nature's Prophet, we also assume we need a Didi Ra style hero. Another side thing to note after Didi Ra's Lycan performance during Star Ladder, obviously he's always going to get that banned out in the second phase against him if it does go through. And if you pick him up too early, then he's a little bit too easy to counter. And Zeus, so say hello to Dendi's hero. Meaning, once again, we find ourselves in the position where it's just the one position here is left over. Spectre is almost a must ban right now. There's too much global. With the Bounty Hunter setup, running Thunder God's Wrath, Wrath of Nature, like, that's a lot of Wrath to go through, and then you add a Spectral Haunt into the mix as well.
Into the mix as well.
Oh, hello. I'm hearing myself through you. What did you do, Swindles?
Is that better or worse?
That's actually better.
Okay, cool. Awesome.
Yeah. Apart from the first bit when I heard myself talking, but apart from that, it's a little great.
Oh, awesome. I like the Zeus pick here, actually. This gives them crazy global potential, and Zeus and Furion together is always, like, super annoying. Now they just last pick a hero that does physical damage and applies tower pressure, and the Na'Vi draft is really solid.
I'm wondering if Nodiggity is actually... because, like, Spectre's the first thing that comes to my mind. Way too much global. But the Lone Druid also tore them a new one. And you talk about tower pressure is what made me think of it.
I think Lone Druid would be pretty scary for them. I love the Zeus Lone Druid combo.
Their other option is they actually run an Era Lone Druid. I'm hearing myself again through you, man.
What, really?
Yeah.
What the hell, man?
It comes and goes though. Like, it's very, very weird.
Oh, you know what it is? It's because you're coming through so loud on my headset. My mic's picking you up. I'll just turn that down. Should be fine.
Yeah, smooth. Yeah, but like, if Nodiggity wanted, they could ban the Spectre and pick the Lone Druid themselves. Because they also really don't have... like, they got Chen to try and push down the towers, but up against an Enchantress, that's never really guaranteed. And up against so much global and spam from Zeus and Nature's Prophet, maybe actually having something like Lone Druid for themselves could be a better option.
Perhaps. I actually don't... ban Lone Druid. I'm not afraid of Spectre if I'm Diggity. They might even be considering picking it, to be honest. It's quite good here, but I don't really think you're afraid of it if you have a Chen. Like, if you beat that sort of draft with an all-in, and, I mean, that's what they gotta do. So, let me get my roommates to be quiet. Okay, 1 second.
You're all good, man. 5 seconds remaining. That's a Na'Vi. How do you do this one? What do you want to do? Reserve time. There's still...
Right, so...
Yeah, go on.
No. Oh, yeah. You don't have a prediction for the pick here?
The only prediction I have is a Spectre ban, unless they want to pick it themselves. Like, that's it. Like, if they let Spectre through, then this Zeus and Enchantress are going to have a bit of a rough time. 10 seconds remaining. Mm. And especially Nature's Prophet, because that's one thing No Diggity don't have. Like, they have Nightstalker once he reaches Aghanim's Scepter to find the Nature's Prophet. Actually, they... Okay, maybe they're worried about the counter push, but, like, Spectre's the one that's going to catch out the Prophet and kill him off really quickly.
Mm-hmm. It's an interesting ban, too. Maybe they were... I don't know. Maybe Na'Vi is thinking about picking PL. I can't really think of any other reason to ban the Ember here. It's definitely a strong pick, but I don't think that
it's the push
you can
army.
Afford to be afraid of it.
Like when you put a whole bunch of trains as well as Enchantress army together, you can't just push with it. And they go a Slaughter pickup as their final one.
Mm-hmm. Yep, they're going to do the Corphurion. I actually really like this from Na'Vi. They're just going to hunt with the Bounty and the Slardar, look for kills. They're going to need to apply a lot of pressure to the Spectre early game, and I think Bounty Slardar can do a pretty good job of that, especially if the Ench rotates, and of course they're always threatening the Prophet TP, and once they get Zeus ult, like, they can just apply so much pressure. A big part of this game is going to be, I think, on Coypha and Yapzor. Puck has to rotate really early, specifically to ensure his Spectre has a good game. Keizu's probably going to have a tough time top. I don't believe that he does well against Prophet at all. They're going to need to utilize that first night time to really make things happen. But I think Na'Vi's on the clock, but I favor their draft maybe like 70-30.
10 seconds remaining. It does feel kind of nice. Oh, if that clock... So what's the 30% for you? Like, what's the 30%? How do they lose this game?
The CM Chen... They secure the safe lane really easily for Diggity. They just get like a good smoke rotation from like CM and Chen. They shut down the Slardar, and then they get earlier towers. It really comes down to tempo control. These are like the withering days of the patch, and most teams have figured this out by now. But the teams that kill the first towers and then control the map are normally in a big advantage. One of the reasons I like Dire so much and why it's actually curious to me Diggity took Radiant is that if you take this tower on Dire, you suddenly open up like this entire area of the map. It's insane. And it gives you Roche, it gives you your Ancients controlled, and you can control a huge portion of the Radiant jungle. And especially in a game where there's an Ench and a Chen, that's really important. So I'd say if Na'Vi take this tower by 8 minutes, they win for sure. 10 minutes, they win 80%. And then like if they haven't taken it by 15, they lose. That's my prediction.
Wow. 30 seconds to battle. We'll see how close that is to the truth. Put your stopwatches on, boys. You can start them in 23 seconds as we'll go for the first runes. No Diggity being very defensive. Every time I see No Diggity actually like move back like this, I just think of, like, I remember what Power Rangers did to them. Like, 3 times in a row, they just ran at him. But they're actually going to fight for bottom rune. Koifa's already in here, and he's actually taking some decent damage. Down to 1/3 of his life already. General moves over. This actually means that No Diggity will not claim either of the runes. Prophet's already up on top, and Zeus will take the one for the mid. So you're already starting from behind. Puck burning his consumables early on. Doesn't get the bottle money as well.
Yeah, that's one of the big downsides of playing so passive in the early game, well, like before the game starts, is that you don't have any vision control and you can get a little, not necessarily outplayed, but that's just a strategy thing, you know. Chen's gonna start at this hard camp over here. He gets a centaur. That's the worst spawn, unfortunately. And Chen also gets a centaur, so neither jungler getting the mighty satyr, which would assuredly win them the lane in mid,
which is funny because in the last game that was exactly the first creeps which came up.
It's actually such a huge deal and something that I feel like a lot of people ignore, but the spawns you get in the jungle are actually so important.
I think Yabzor is also flagging the fact that Snaco's leeching experience, but it's like Snaco's having a harder time. Like it's the worst camps right now for him to try and fight against, and Yabzor's just like, screw it, I'm just gonna steal a purge creep.
I'm surprised he didn't get the mana burn one. I think that would have been more effective, especially since he's out of mana pots on Snaco.
Yeah. He's only got 2 more Ghost Walks left. Or Shadow Walks.
The big thing to note here is that top lane, although it is going quite well for KZ right now, I think Furion will win this matchup. And bottom lane, the Slardar should have a pretty good time as well.
Have a look to mid.
Can't really zone him.
Alistar's going to smoke around. Smoke breaks on his creeps because Yabzor's just sitting in the tree line at the moment. But Snaco will give him the vision required. Now, Yabzor, he doesn't see Alistar until now. So now he sees the creep army is on its way. Snake Girl trying to slow it up. Now she steals the purge creep to slow down Yapzor. He tries to actually happy tree at the moment. Can't do it with the Centaur Storm. Does he have the space? Nope, he does not. Astar will take the first blood. And the happy tree shall basically be fertilized with the corpse of the Chen.
That was very strange. Yapzor just paused for quite some time. And I think he might have been able to live there, but it took him like 2 seconds to take that centaur back. Or over, rather. He's going to get the illusion bottom. Then he's going to get the bounty rune top. Really important that Zeus is able to control runes here. Also, he's having a pretty good lane against the Puck. He's winning the CS, which is kind of unexpected for me. I think Puck should win this matchup. But it is Dendi.
Yeah. It is also a Puck who had one tango, has had no bottles, didn't buy up the salve, so Koifa hasn't had life to fight in this lane. And Dendi, because he got the rune and was involved in, like, it's a hard knock life.
Another thing to note is just that the levels, like specifically level 6s for Na'Vi, are so important here on all of their heroes, and that trades
bottom
are
lane,
very
Era. There's your purge creep going to work again with the troll trap. They try and hold Era in position. He makes a run for the tree line, the crush. Generally just another half a second to get his secondary crush over on Era. Now Sudeiko way too close towards the tower. Takes a couple of hits thanks to Cinder and Frostbiting him up in range of the tier 1.
Yep. This is the big advantage for Enchantress against the Chen, is he can be way more active early on. Chen has the advantage as he gets more like the creep army going, but at the moment he's just not able to put as much pressure out on the map. And this is going to be really scary, especially when the Zeus and the Prophet get 6, and suddenly there could be a bounty, a Zeus ult, and a Furion just right on top of you anywhere on the map, and you just don't have any idea. So. Again, Na'Vi just has to continue to control tempo, and they'll be in a really good spot in this game. If you look at CS, they're definitely winning in every lane.
Era, troll trapped up. He does have Spectral Dagger, so it makes a break for the tree line. As Astal, not too healthy, and now in comes Dendi. They're looking for Cinderin, and there's the crush. Cinderin will die, and Na'Vi will claim their second kill. Astal's still very, very low. Now he's got level 3, he might be able to sprite himself up.
Yeah, it is dark nighttime now, which is really important. This is one of the issues with having like Puck and Nightstalker on the team, where just neither one wants to rotate super early, and neither one is super powerful, you know? Puck will have her coil eventually, but it's just, it's tough for Diggity. This is a hard game for them. They're still in this, obviously, but they need to ensure that they make a move sometime soon. You see Yapzor just really struggling, still with a purge creep. Only level 2, looking to grab another one, but Seneko's done a really good job. He's already found him again.
Yapzor's going to get frustrated about this. Hearing an Aegis Prophet TPing in right in front. Thunder goes right. It's going to commit a little bit of extra damage to help kill off Yapzor. Managed to steal a Wild Wing Ripper, but okay, yeah, that doesn't really last long.
One of the reasons Bounty Prophet is so good against Chen is exactly what we just saw. They just find him and he's dead. In the meantime, Archstyle goes down to 9 HP in the mid lane.
Yeah, he actually had an opening to try and find a couple of kills, but he was up against both Cinderin as well as Koifa. But the Thunder God's Wrath gave him a little bit of extra damage to go to work. Yeah. But this is something which I've seen from Nodiggity before. Not the fact, like, obviously Cinderin getting ganked, like, that we've seen before, but Cinderin, oh my! Okay, yeah, there's a lot of nuke damage. Revenge will be served up by Koifa, so it'll be a Crystal Maiden for an Enchantress. But it's the fact that Nightstalker, Keizu, gets given so much space, this Aghanim Scepter comes online a lot earlier than most Nightstalkers.
You say that, but look, check out the CS disparity between Spectre and Slaughter right now.
Yeah, Era's got Jack all.
Yep. This is kind of the problem with the Spectre pick here, where you just don't zone. Like, you don't have any presence in lane. Like, Slaughter just straight up bullied CM and Spectre, and then obviously the rotations helped, but you just can't really do anything to this hero. He should see the smoke gank because of that Zeus ulti.
And General backs up just the right time because of it.
Look how low Spectre is. No health regen. Yeah.
Okay, Dioside didn't have any vision of that Invis rune, so they won't be aware of this, but yeah, Era. Well, they try and steal the Hellbear, try and slow down Arstyle, in comes Keizu. So you lost your Spectre, but this will allow Keizu to get a kill over on one. Crush comes out, Keizu actually delaying his movement in, so he doesn't actually get caught by the Crush as well. They keep that Purge creep going to work. One more second, they've actually got it. It's amazing how powerful these neutrals are. Like, that Purge has such a low cooldown. How are you meant to run away? Like, it's a 3-second cooldown for a 5-second duration.
And it doesn't taper off like a lot of other purges do, or at least not as rapidly. Sindarin is really aggressively positioned right now. He just dies if this... Yeah, he might just... I don't know. I would be killing him if I were a Furion Bounty, but he's going to escape.
Furion actually triggered the Wrath of Nature, but because Sindarin hid inside the tree line, he didn't get hit by it. It hit a creep in the lane right next to him, but he didn't actually get hit by it. So Sindarin's trying to get really greedy as far as taking out this farm. Casey's trying to make the most out of the end of this nighttime as well. Because you have to ask, like, successful nighttime. You got one kill, you got one assist, and you're up at level 7.5 on a Nightstalker. Is this enough for you?
I don't believe so. Oh, they're going to call on mid.
This could be enough. Dendi, here comes just Spectral Horn, trying to get Ear into the mix-up. There's Dendi. Well, there's a crush from General. Catching out two, lets the Thunder God's Wrath off. Keizu walks himself away, but that Centaur stomp. Hitting both Seneko as well as General. Yapsil's looking for the body block, realizing they're going to run straight through. Keizu, Iron Talons, not only his Iron Talons, just a Quellian Blade's way out of the tree line, but it's still not enough time. It'll go down. And Yapsil crushed up as well in the tree line. Welcome back to daytime. And the light dawns on Na'Vi.
There's just so much more damage on Na'Vi's team right now. There's so much damage output. They have so much map presence. And like you saw there, like they all land on Zeus, Puck, Spectre, Nightstalker, they all use their spells, but he just kind of doesn't die because that's it. And then they're just out of abilities and they have to run away. That's the second tower for Na'Vi. And they're just going to rotate towards bottom now and then probably look to Roche after. And I mean, this is getting scary. This is before even Track comes online and Na'Vi's already 4k gold, 5k gold ahead.
Well, they've taken every tower. They've taken every tower as well, apart from the important one you're talking about in bottom lane. But it looks like the time is limited for that to stay alive as well. But what does No Diggity even do? Like, you've got smoke over on the Chen. You found yourself a status. That's one upside. Keizu is actually burn up. Yeah, he blocks up the camp as well. So you get a Hellbear as well as a Sata. Dyer's
middle tower. You fire your drafter, man. That's the only move.
Sorry, Sindarin can't be fired. He's the one that put the team together.
No, I'm just kidding. It's just... Na'Vi just, I think, understands this meta much better than other teams right now. Part of the reason they did so well at Star Ladder. This is just really solid Dota right now.
Yeah,
and
they're
in a great position. Everyone's here except for Furion, so they're fine with this team fight for sure. Aether lands on Zeus. He'll
they need 2 seconds for Spectral Haunt. There's a Dream Call. Again, they start over on Denny with the Silence Forward. Denny's still going to be Thunder God's Wrath off, but that Spectral Haunt, they're all over Na'Vi. Two heroes down already. They'll trigger off the dust, so Seneko now revealed, but a hostile Chen Stomp. I say Chen Stomp, the Centaur Stomp. Does this work, and they just keep chasing after Arstyle. Voids of cooldown in 2 seconds time. That'll be enough to find the kill. The attack will not in Arstyle. Okay, there's your Void. Finds the pickoff, and Seneko was able to TP himself away. So two big calls, while it's a support down for Na'Vi. They do not claim that tier 1 tower in bottom lane. But it does have 48 HP, so it's not far away from a still certain death.
That was actually a mistake by Seneko. There wasn't even a blink on Puck, but no one was there to break that smoke, and he actually just like ran in and coiled. Seneko needed to be standing here, and that would have popped the smoke. And the tower will go down after 10 minutes, though, so we'll see. That was a really needed fight for Diggity. I think that goes without saying. Their Chen is now finally going to hit level 6. The Spectre is able to recover a little bit, but Ira is still so far behind. They actually need to continue getting kills, or they're going to be very, very hard out farmed.
Well, every time Spectral Horn comes off cooldown, they can go for it. So every 2 minutes, they can initiate. And then with the Blink Dagger like arriving fairly soon over on Quaitfa, they're going to have that opportunity. Yabzor now has Hand of God for the next fight, even though he doesn't have the mech done.
Look at net worth. Toby.
Yeah, I see Prophet and Zeus just like sitting pretty on the top two.
Look at where Era is, man. He's under the Chen right now.
Life is hard, man.
Yeah, that's the big problem right now for No Diggity, is that it's so hard to get the Spectre involved in the game. I mean, obviously his ult is fantastic, but if he isn't strong enough to actually like make these... I don't know how to explain it, but if the hero's this weak, he can't really... He's not a threat. And... now it's even scarier. They have a soon finished Vale on the Zeus with an Aegis, and they're just going to push towers as far as Dityarath Farms. He's going to go for a Maelstrom just to accelerate.
I'm wondering if Diggity should be looking for initiation first, then. Because right now it looks like if we put everything together which Na'Vi has got, like, they're going to win the fight. If they're the ones that decide when the fight happens and where it happens. But if you're able to get that blink coil off, like, you get an initiation off, like, Sindarin's dead right now. Like, there's nothing that's going to save him at all. He came in to put an aggressive Observer Ward down, throws out the shortest ulti in history, and will actually lose his Observer Ward as he threw it down when he was being initiated on. So that's not so great.
A lot of gold. That's just an easy track kill. They're gonna initiate on bottom a little bit, but to no avail. Slaughter is very close to blink, as you said. Actually choosing to max his sprint over his stun. I've never seen anybody do that before.
I know a lot of players actually completely bypass the bash.
Mm-hmm.
This is the older build over on Slaughter, because you understood that the bash was a percentage chance, where the crush is, like, obviously guaranteed damage, and he can do more with a sprint. That impetus damage, Keizu's dead. Dityarath might actually be stuck inside the tree line with a spectral haunted illusion, but it doesn't even matter. Even gets a Maelstrom proc from out in the tree lines. General actually scurries himself away. One charge will be off in a off cooldown in a moment, but it looks like right now Na'Vi, they're walking all over, no diggity. Track kills kicking in, you burn an Aegis Immortal over on Zeus, but who really cares? You still take out all the towers on that safe plane of no diggity.
Yep. You just can't fight Na'Vi's lineup if you don't pick something off pretty much immediately. And that's really difficult to do. The hero you wanted to kill there is the Zeus, but he had the Aegis, so not really going to do much. They're going to have the blink now on Slardar, and Na'Vi's jump just gets way scarier. Man, look at the net worth. Like, Spectre's just so out of this game, and I just don't see how he gets back into it.
It does seem like an impossible task right now. Like, if you had the Aghanim Scepter on Keizu, maybe you could prepare for these fights a little bit better, but, you know, that doesn't even help you. Like, seeing what's coming, understanding that a freight train is going to hit you in the face, doesn't make any difference. The freight train is still going to hit you in the face. You just see it coming a little bit sooner.
I don't know what to say about this game, man. I feel so bad for Ira, though. This is, like, the grimmest game I've seen a carry have in a long time. And I don't even know if he's got one death, you know? Five assists. Mm-hmm. He's not, like, playing especially bad. It's just there was nothing doing in that bottom lane, man.
Can you even fault it on the draft? Like, you're not going to expect a Slaughter as your last pickup all the time.
Well, it's not even about the Slaughter, though. I mean, the issue is that they just didn't secure the safe lane. Like, no matter what hero they pick for Ira there, you know it's going to be greedy. You have Puck and Nightstalker as your cores, so, like, you have to pick something that's a hard one. And anything you put there, if Chen isn't able to help, is going to be bullied really hard just because of the natural weakness of CM plus said hero. Maybe Sven could have done something, like, hero like that, but he's obviously kind of susceptible to sprouts and just Zeus doing massive damage.
Everyone is stealing each other's creeps.
Mech finished on Sinaco. He actually beats the Chen to his mech.
It's amazing what, like, three track kills can help you with. And there goes your tier 2 tower. 15 minutes in and instantly into a smoke. Na'Vi do not want to hang around. Like, Sindarin is again playing this really close game, but it's the Dire Observer Ward. They saw Keizu farming. Like, we hit nighttime now, so the vision's not so great. Thunder God's Wrath reveals out a couple of heroes. But can they find Keizu? Dityarath? He can TP right now, Keizu, if he wants to. General's too far away. He have to go for, like, a blind crush. Dityarath
really
put out
close.
The sprout to give him that extra bit of vision, but it's still a little bit too late.
Yeah, I like that move, though, from Na'Vi. And even though they don't get kills, what they do is they force the Diggity heroes right back into their base. Now, if you look at bottom lane, mid lane, they're both pushed very hard for Dire. And now Na'Vi just group up. They're going to push this tier 2 top. So it's just an easy way to sort of herd them back towards their base so that they can capture an objective without losing map control.
General really wants to have a crack at this mid. Does he have any... Thunder God's Wrath as well as Wrath of Nature is on cooldown, and there's no reason to jump in like that. But just take out the tier 2 tower.
is under attack.
Dragon Lance on Furion, by the way. Something Diggarad does a bunch. I actually kind of like it in a game like this too. Just helped us get some good stats and just helps with sieging. Chasing the puck, they're not going to find him.
At least the Chen army can escape from General. Sneko can have a bit of a wander around too. They have any detection at all? Like, Koifa's... Okay, you got dust over on Yapsaw, but that's the only detection they have available.
Yeah, and this is what's so scary. So you can already see the Slardar just turned. He's going to come looking... If he sends the puck, like, the puck just dies to Zusalti and the Slardar with the bounty there. And that's, like, the threat of this draft, is that you have so much global potential, and you're able to gather so much more information than the enemy team. The big item to turn this all around is going to be the Ags on Keizu, but I don't know if a vision advantage is even going to help them that much, solely because they are so far behind in terms of just raw damage output. In addition, Zeus and Furion are both quite good against the Nightstalker Ags, because obviously the Zeus ult gives vision. You can scout with Furion trees, and you don't really get abused as hard by the 1800 clear vision he runs around with.
It could help if you can get the gem as well onto the Nightstalker. Then at least you'll understand what the Bounty Hunter is preparing to attack into you. You'll understand at least the vision game. So Na'Vi... Yeah, they're going to walk at you. Yeah, as you said, like they're going to scout with trinkets, but at least you can get rid of the permanent vision that comes out from the wards. When I say that, Na'Vi actually don't have any... Like, they got one observer ward, and goodbye. Realize how low Sindarin is as well. He tried to smoke and run himself away, but now he's tracked. Sneaker could just shuriken toss this down, but he lets Diddera take the kill. I'm fairly certain after you get hit by Thunderghost, Wrath, and Wrath of Nature like that, you realize how weak you are. The No Diggity, you're probably already having that conversation of like, hey boys, like, I don't know if this is possible anymore.
Yep. They're just counting on the Spectre, but as we've talked about, he's just so far behind. And, you know, Prophet is pretty much countered by Spectre, but in the event that this is the despair, like, again, if he gets tempo control, Prophet's countered by nothing. Because you have so much more map control, and you can farm as your team runs around as four looking to slay, and you're just continuing to accelerate. He's so big right now. He's actually doubled up, Ira.
What is his gold per minute? So his gold per minute is currently sitting at 579, compared to Ira's 273. This is just very one-sided, to say the least. And Keizu's having to hide in the tree line. He's got 1 second till he can TP out, which is now. He's already completed up the ag. Starts the TP. It was a little bit late, so he might be caught out. In fact, he will be. General gets the crush off. Track and amplify. There's nowhere to hide for this Nightstalker. Prophet will TP in as well, so everyone can be involved in the money kills. And say goodbye to your Nightstalker.
Yep. And see, if it weren't for the tracks, that wouldn't be a huge deal, but... I mean, over the past 5 minutes, Na'Vi's lead has gone from about 6k to 14, and that's mostly in part to all of these track kills. It just, again, just helps their draft so much. It puts them in a position where they can pretty much only lose the game at this point. They have it won. They just need to control objectives, continue starving the map, get a good Roche, and just siege when they're 20, 30k ahead. Mm-hmm. Vlad's on Sineko. He's just getting all the support items.
I was actually waiting for it to finish up something like Grease, but with the Vlads as well, like this lineup from Na'Vi is just becoming brutal. Like, it's not just the fact that Nature's Prophet's now got the range with a full Mjolnir completed over on him with and Dragon Lance, but you then look it towards the Enchantress. Like, Artstyle is now 1,000. Does he actually have the other? Yeah, he does. He's actually finished his Aghanim Scepter in under 20 minutes on this Enchantress, plus the Dragon Lance. Like, the only thing we're missing right now is Slaughter to have a BKB, but he's actually building in for a 4-staff instead.
Yeah. I don't know if you saw, but so Enchantress and Slaughter ran through this ward like this, and they actually forced the Spectre to just run back to base, even though it was just the two of them and his entire team is alive. The threat of the Furion TP and the Zeus ulti, just coupled with how far behind they are, forces him to retreat. And now, like, Diggity's just in such a tough spot. No one can even afford a gem right now. So this Ags is nice, but... if they run over a ward, it's not going to matter.
Well, at least Ira does get some space up on top lane without being instantly attacked by Na'Vi. But Sindarin, well, close TP out. And they will get away from the Na'Vi gank. Space created. For now. Navi don't really care, though. In 1 minute's time, Roshan will spawn. They'll take him out, and that'll be their license to go for a slightly aggressive play. Depending on how many players of No Diggity they kill off, will depend if they actually, like, breach the high ground or not. And damn, this is gonna be frustrating right now for Chen. He can't keep an army up just pushing out the lane because Arstar comes in and steals the best creep he possibly can from it. In this case, the Sada Tormentor.
I don't know, man.
General.
I'm actually really...
Blink. Thunder goes Wrath. Ira's in trouble. Syndra needs to create some space and he can't do it. About to go to the tree line. Throws the ulti out. The sprite actually bought him a little bit of space to do it. But now with a dream call, it only catches out two and then Mjolnir. Okay. Yeah. Okay, that's not just salt in the wound. That's like electrocuted salt.
It's just so odd to see Na'Vi playing so disciplined. It's really just crazy. Like, they actually are back. Their drafts are on point. I just hope that they can continue this for all their fans, like, into the new patch. Because they've certainly got this one figured out, but I imagine the Frog will be changing a lot of things in a couple days.
Chen and Enchantress nerfed. Does Na'Vi still function?
I think they'd still be okay. I like their Witch Doctor IO strat a lot, I think. It's mostly just that they've found a style, and each player has sort of developed a role. Mm-hmm. Seneko's just playing the fear role, just running around the map trying to kill things. General's playing Initiator. Dendi's just in mid, and then Art Style's desperately trying not to feed as he heals his team. And it works for them.
Uh-huh.
They're going to take this Roche, which is the right move. Diggity can try to fight, but they don't have coil for a few seconds. The Dagon's up, but I think he's already dead.
You see that kind of fear. Equalium bladed down a tree as opposed to the Observer one, and then was still so fearful to walk back in range of the Obs and start attacking it because he thought he would be initiated on.
Yep.
And that's just like fear, plain and simple. Yeah, it will be interesting to see if Na'Vi can carry it across. Obviously you have like one patch wonder teams. They just work so well with certain types. Like, a lot of questions were asked about OG about that kind of stuff as well. Like, if they were just that kind of patch-only kind of team. But they're slowly picking themselves up as well. Yeah. Hey, you should know, man. Some of them are your former teammates.
The much better players that I'll never win a game without. I haven't forgotten.
Hey, I didn't say it.
It's all good.
There's gonna be some level of beef, man, or else there's no rivalries.
There's no beef. It's just like there's
yeah, beef's still part of complexity,
win,
right?
You know what I mean? That's the only thing that really matters. If you win,
Yapsol.
You're the best. The
oh, Yapsol! Oh, Yapsol! That's
he got the slow off though. He did get the slow off.
That's value slow. This is just pure siege. Like, because they both got dragon lances, Arstyle and Dinarad don't give a crap. Like, you actually can't reach them when they do plays like this, and everyone is tracked. Every single player from Diggity, apart from the Spectre, who's just not there, is tracked up. Cinder and so low, there goes your Thunder God's Wrath. 62 life for the Dire Stalker, because this game is over. Like, yep. Spectre isn't even haunting him for a very, very good reason. He'll die straight away.
This is the definition of, like, the first strategy I ever ran in Han back in, like, 09. We called it LRC, where you just picked a bunch of long-range heroes. We centralized it around Chipper, if you remember that guy.
Oh.
And you just shoot at the other team.
Yeah, I remember that guy.
I never actually think it worked, but this one is. And they're just going to do the same thing top, man. There's just nothing No Diggity can do. Is this losers or winners?
Yeah, this is losers. No Diggity, you're out if they lose this best of three. This is... into the next round after this, we're actually into the lower bracket small final.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, where there's only three more series after this game. That's all. So we have the winner's bracket final, which is, three more series, because we have two qualifiers from Europe for ESL 1 Frankfurt. So either VP or Vega will be attending ESL 1 Frankfurt, and then we'll have a team from the lower bracket. So it's Spirit versus potentially Na'Vi. So we've got two CIS teams that will be attending ESL 1 Frankfurt. That is a guarantee of No Diggity get knocked out right now.
That's crazy, actually. CIS would be the top four out of EU.
Considering what happened in China.
Yeah. Well, it, to be fair, though, there is no Liquid or Secret in the qualifier, which definitely weakens it.
Yeah. Well, Liquid got a direct invite, so they'll still be at the event anyway.
Oh, no OG either, actually. Or Alliance.
Oh, Koifa jumps in. It's a nice coil, but the Shuriken toss just keeps bouncing around, and there's an ulti combination. Koifa can hide inside the tree line. When the Vel was dropped on them, too, that's just too easy for Dendy.
He's got a Daedalus, by the way, on the NP. He's still got 2,500 gold.
He's almost hit 20k net worth. We're 26 minutes in, and now they lock down the Nightstalker as well. Does he get himself a crit? No, you got your Impetus damage. And the tracks are still up on everyone. They continue to fight No Diggity when they're fully tracked up. General's got his 4-staff available too. He actually could have 4-staffed into Cinderin just then. And please, like, just like it's watching Apollo having the shit beaten out of him right now. No Diggity, you're down, you're broken, your face is bloody. I will not cut your eye to help you fight continuously. Like, you don't survive this. Radiant's bottom tower is under attack. Cinderin actually being forced out by General. That's almost like a glory ultimate at the end there.
They're just playing with them, man. They just no respect. This is one of the things, though, that I love about Na'Vi, and just I think emphasizes part of why I think they're finding success is that they're actually a real team. You know, they're kind of clowning around, just trying to kill them in base, but all five of them are committed to that task. And you know, Art Style's like tanking tier threes for his team with heal, so that they can pretty much fountain dive, and they're doing it as a unit, and they played well. I think they had a clear strategy in both games, and if you just look, I mean, this game Zeus NP, last game they had Beastmaster Lone Druid, every player is on a comfort hero. I mean, that's vintage Dota, man. That's what you do, and Na'Vi's back.
It definitely looks solid, and man, it's something which I never thought I'd actually hear being said as well about a, like from a pro player talking about Na'Vi. It's like, you know what? They're diving, but they're diving in synchronization. They have a purpose when they're diving after you underneath tier three, tier four towers to allow these kills to happen. But it doesn't even seem wrong. Like when I hear something like that about Na'Vi, I'm expecting, oh, they're diving and they're dying. Like they're losing. It's like somehow they've given so much advantage over to somebody else. But they dive, they take the kill, and then they go back over to the ranks. It's like you're still having fun while still actually having a purpose. And that's something which we haven't seen from Na'Vi in a very long time. And I
don't think there's really a standout player for them either. I think everyone's doing really solid. They all have their jobs and they're just performing. I think previous iterations of Na'Vi were always too Dendy or too Havost focused. And
yeah,
I think this is a good balance where Dendy is obviously still a very talented mid player, but he's not the focal point of the drafts anymore. It's much more synergistic as a whole.
Yeah.
And they also seem to be executing a playstyle that just as always I think been associated with Russian Dota. Just tempo control, aggression, tower dives, hero kills, and you know, come beat us if you can sort of style. And I think they're playing it quite well. And as you said, four CIS teams now in the finals of the EU region. Man,
yeah.
Maybe some NA teams will start moving to Europe, man.
Oh, I'm just going to leave the shots where they are. We're going to wrap up tonight too. It was only the one game we had for you this evening. We do have more ESL 1 games coming up tomorrow night. We'll actually have our winner's bracket final. Virtus Pro will be going up against Vegas Squadron. That game is set for 18 CEST tomorrow night. Of course, you can check out all the ESL 1 Frankfurt games at joinedit.com. Just click on the coverage page. You've got all of the ESL 1 qualifiers up there. Obviously, Manila qualifiers already over. I'll be flying to that one tomorrow with Capitalist and the rest of the boys. So if you want to tune in for that one, we've got 8 of the best teams around the world attending in beautiful Manila for a wonderful event. The first games for that begin on Friday. So we'll have Liquid, Mineski, Complexity, and Wings in Group A, and Secret, Empire, eHome, and Fnatic in Group B. Hoping for some terrific Dota for that one. Also, big thanks to Mobpax who joined me for the first game, and Swindles. Safe flight, man. Safe flight. Hope you get there in
one
piece.
Thanks, buddy. I hope you do too. I just saw Matt tweet out that the heat index is up to like 43 Celsius.
Yeah.
I am thrilled.
Yeah, it's gonna be pretty warm. We sent a message saying that we may not wear well. We may have our first naked stream just because it's gonna be so hot.
I'm bringing like 6 tank tops. You can borrow a couple if you need.
I will never, ever wear a tank top.
Dude, oh man, you gotta wear the tank tops, man.
No, I don't.
Every day
don't.
It's tank top time.
You know, the day I hit 65 kilograms, I'll wear a tank top. All right?
It's just, you'd understand. You'll understand when we're there and just why it's necessary.
Dude, I'm from Australia! Who do you think you're talking to, bro?
Man, it's close, but it doesn't have the humidity of a Manila or a Florida man. While I got you here, what are your predictions out of curiosity for
ESL 1 Manila?
Yeah, I read this. There was this thread on Reddit with predictions, and our team, Complexity, wasn't even mentioned. Like, no one's even there to just say, like, oh, yeah, these guys are going to suck dick. They just, yeah, whatever.
Oh, I have you coming second out of Group A.
Okay.
With Team Liquid as number one.
Wow. That's a really bold prediction there, Toby.
I know. It's so crazy. Group A is actually probably the easier one to predict. Group B, however, I actually have Secret as one and Fnatic as second.
Really?
With E-Home and then Empire following through.
Yeah, I will see, but I don't know. I'm actually really happy we got the group that we did. I think the Group B teams are really scary. In my opinion, it's just the Fnatic is the outlier because I just think Fnatic is just incredible. Like I think they're 9-0 against MVP over the past month. Like yeah. They're just destroying the region without even having Mushi playing. I mean, they're just such a scary team right now. Dota's in a great spot, and chances are we'll have a patch before this LAN. If the updates to the test server are any tell, so we'll see what happens. But
really? You think it's going to come? If it's going to come, it's going to come tonight. They can't delay it any further than tonight. Like, the first game is over on Friday. You're going to say before, like, a $250,000 major event in Manila, like, you're going to release a patch, like, 2 days before it? Eh.
Oh, also, can I do a little shameless self-promotion? I'm, like, 300 followers from 10,000. Can you guys just all go follow me on Twitter, yo? I'm serious, man. I've got Pepsi.
His name is Swindles. Put it in the chat. Go and follow him on Twitter. He needs to increase his e-penis. So go help him increase his e-penis.
Yep. And, I don't know. I'll do something special. I'll get some dudes to Toby. I know the fans really want those.
Brilliant. All right, guys. Thanks for watching. We'll see you back here again tomorrow for more ESL1 action. Of course, I won't be here. You'll have Dark Dota doing your streaming from now. So thanks for watching, everyone, and I will see you on the Manila stream next time.